Gets. But me, I never left. I remember all of it. We made an oath.
Swear? If it isn't dead, if it ever comes back, we'll come back to you.
We didn't stop it.
Pennywise.
The clown.
We can't let it happen again.
Welcome, everybody, to The Cast from the Coast. My name is Adam Miles, and I'm joined, as always, by Tim, the Dancing Clown Johnson.
I wasn't expecting that intro, but thank you. Hello!
You're welcome, man. How you doing?
I'm just happy to be here.
You're happy to be here.
I'm happy to be doing this again. I'm just happy.
That's good, man. That's good. Moving down the virtual table, we also have Josh Lambert.
Hey, how's it going, guys?
Good, man. How you doing?
Good, buddy.
Just happy to be here.
That's right.
That's right.
That's all you can be.
Just happy to be here, gentlemen. Excellent. So, everybody's been wondering what's been going on with They Cast from the Coast. It's pretty simple. Tim took a sabbatical.
They
have been. They've been asking. People have been asking. So, you know, we got to say it. Tim took a sabbatical.
Yeah.
He took some Tim time.
Yeah, I had to find myself.
He had to center himself.
Center myself.
Get his fucking chakras realigned and shit like that, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Some serious soul searching.
Yeah.
So what did you find, Tim?
His soul.
Yeah, I found my soul. Well,
fucking anticlimactic. What the fuck? Well, it's all good. But in all seriousness, folks, we did have some downtime. There was a lot going on. Life just kind of gets in the way. And you know what? Just recently, I called up Tim and Josh and said, you know what? We need to get this shit going again because we love talking about movies.
That's partly true. You're telling part of the truth. You messaged me and asked me to do a podcast like we never did a podcast before.
No, that's not true.
We can think about doing a podcast, maybe centering it on horror. And I was like, are you serious? Like, are you kidding me right now? You want to do, let's just do the one that we did. No, we got to do a podcast about horror. It's never been done before.
It's never been done. Yeah, because those words came out of my mouth. A podcast on horror has never been done before, Tim.
No. That's not what I meant. What I meant was, let us do a podcast like we've never done a podcast on horror before.
That's all full of shit you are, Tim. No. I did message Tim. I thought that it would be good to get something else up off the ground, you know, just because by the time that, you know, everything has been said and done, this has been kind of, you know, sleeping for a while. I didn't know if it was good to kind
7
of,
months.
7 months. I didn't know if it was good to kind of, you know, resuscitate
for a little bit. Yes, of resuscitate. They cast from the coast.
Tim
was good.
Tim said, "No, let's do it." So here we are, everybody. They Cast from the Coast is back. We'll be recording regular episodes. And to keep it fresh and to keep content flowing, we're going to be doing some different things. We're going to be doing our standard review episodes. We're going to be breaking the roundtable bullshitting episodes where we talk about random topics and whatever's in the news and whatever just comes to mind, including what the hell we've been watching or playing for video games. And that's going to be a separate episode on its own. And then we're going to have other episodes, some very interesting ones that we're working on. Josh has something that he's working on. He's got up his sleeve. Ooh, very dastardly. I can't wait till everybody hears what Josh is fucking working on, because it's kind of blowing my mind. And ever since he's been talking about it, it's been great. I'm not going to get into any details right now, but it's going to be a good surprise for everybody. And just anything else that we can think of. We're literally just going to pop on the microphone and talk and spew random bullshit at times. And people are going to love it.
We're talking about bullshit.
Bullshit!
We speak the truth.
We speak the truth.
Pertinent information.
Pertinent information. So that's the gist of it, everybody. We're going to be coming back with a lot more stuff coming up here soon. We're just going to continue They Cast from the Coast as it is. Thanks for sticking around and waiting for us, basically. So we hope we don't let you down. And we're going to kick off tonight, though, with something very special. The three of us went to an advanced screening last night of It Chapter 2. We seen it on a Wednesday night. The movie premieres on a Friday night, and we're recording this after having seen the movie and getting all of our thoughts together before almost anybody else has seen the movie now at this point. So this has been good. It was a good night, and we're going to get right into it. Anything to add, gentlemen, before we start into the review for the night?
Can we just talk about the fact that for the first time ever going into a screening, there was a security checkpoint? They were checking for metal.
No.
Weapons.
But it wasn't just that. It's like recording devices.
Yeah.
And the last three or four pre-screenings that I've gone to have had that, because they're really trying to cut down on the camera aspect. Did you notice the two security guards that kept coming in?
Patrolling the halls.
Yeah, and they were
the monocular.
Yeah, and they were looking, you know.
Yeah, they're looking, the monocular that they're using finds glare off of camera lenses. So lenses, they can see lenses bouncing light back to them, IR light back to them. So it's interesting, because you can see the little red when he's doing this. You can see like the red coming out of his monocular the whole time, right? It's just an IR bounce.
It was very unimmersive.
Yeah, it did kind of take you out of things every now and then.
No, it did. I'm just kidding.
Oh well. All right.
These guys just trying to do their job.
They were just trying to do their job, and but it definitely was basically a fucking TSA security checkpoint pat down when you were going through to watch this movie. On a positive note, the representative from Warner Brothers was there. That's normally there when me and Tim go to watch a screening, and historically, Tim and I, it's hit or miss when we go to a screening. You know, not all of them are horror movies. One of the first ones that we ever went to was Dunkirk. And let's just say I hated that movie with such a passion that when I was leaving the theater, the Warner Brothers representative was there, and he had the little clipboard iPad thing going, "May I ask you for your opinion?"
Big smile.
And Tim basically says that it's almost like I went like fucking blank and started to like almost attack the guy. "Let me fucking tell you, it's bullshit." And Tim's like fucking holding me back here and stuff. And
that's called embarrassment.
It's embarrassment too.
I was embarrassed because it wasn't just a normal, "I'm going to give my opinion." Like, you verbally assaulted this man, and he just works there. He didn't make the movie, and he asked you politely, and you just went off.
Well, you know, that's what fucking happens when you're involved in a movie like that, I guess, in some way.
So that was the first time we met him.
That was the first time. Tell him about the second time, Tim.
So what was the second movie?
The Nun.
The Nun.
The Nun. Yeah. So we go to The Nun, which is also a Warner Brothers release. We come out of the theater. The guy's there with the clipboard.
Same guy.
Smile, same fucking guy. And I went, "Oh, dear God." And he must see like hundreds of thousands of people doing this job. And like, I don't think he remembered you at first. But it was the same thing. Like, it wasn't as much of an assault on him, but it was just as bad. I just walked away. Like, I didn't even wait for Adam. Like, I just walked away.
I had to stop myself, too. I remember that.
And, dear God, he was there again last night with the clipboard, and we just walked past him.
Yeah, I didn't even make eye contact. I was just like head down, like, because I mean, I should have given the guy some credit though, because, and everybody will find out from this review, it was the first time at a Warner Brothers screening that I enjoyed myself. And the one time that he was there that I could have very well have walked up to him and said, "Good fucking movie. I enjoyed myself tonight." And I avoided eye contact the whole fucking time.
That guy needed that.
He needed that reassurance, and I fucking avoided it. I was just afraid that it would be like history repeating itself, and I just like fucking attack him for no reason. I don't know.
That poor bastard. That
poor guy. So to the guy who works in Halifax for Warner Brothers at these screenings, sorry. I guess. I don't know. All right, gentlemen. Let's talk about the movie. Tim, do you want to give a slight story breakdown, as if people don't know what Chapter 2 is already about?
Well, if you can take from the title, this is part 2, a sequel, if you will, to the blockbuster smash from 2017, the highest grossing horror movie of all time to date.
Yeah.
It. Chapter 1. Chapter 2 picks up 27 years later after their first encounter with the terrifying Pennywise the Dancing Clown. The Losers Club have all grown up and moved away until a devastating phone call brings them all back to the horrific, simply horrific town of Derry.
Puke-inducing phone call, too, nonetheless. Puke-inducing.
Oh, yeah.
Excellent.
I was eating popcorn when that happened, and I gagged a little.
It was perfect.
They do the effects right.
Absolutely. I mean, right down to the right down to the simple vomit effect that it was for Bill Hader is great. So, all right. So let's talk for a moment about the overall story, because
didn't I just do that?
Well, you gave a synopsis. This is good. So, what we got to understand is that a lot of people are going to be going into this movie comparing it ultimately to two things. One, the book, obviously. Two.
Three things,
okay. One, the book. Two, the original miniseries.
And three, It Chapter 1.
Yeah, okay. I mean, they're going to compare the sequel to the first. True. Okay.
It's very true.
It's very true, yes.
Because you probably did it. I know Josh did it. I know I did it.
Yes. Okay. So I did, but a different type of comparison. I guess I'm talking more or less
sorry. It's just we haven't done this in a while, and there's a lot of pent-up aggression towards Adam.
Give it out, Tim. Bring it out. So, yeah. So a lot of people are going to be going in comparatively, you know, watching the movie and doing a comparison to the other sources of material for this. So I found overall, when it came to the story, they really did do a good amount. They did the proper, in my opinion, choosing of what they put on screen. You know, like when you look at the original miniseries and you compare that to the book, there was a lot missing, just as there is in this one. But it's almost like the shit that they chose not to put in and the shit that they chose to put in instead, it was prime. It was juicier. It was better. Yeah. It made, in my opinion, for a better overall story, because you know that at no point are you going to get a perfect retelling of a book in movie format. There's no such thing. It just has not happened.
But another point, and this is what kind of shaped my opinion after the fact, is that it was written in 1986 while Stephen King was heavily under the influence of cocaine. Right? It was a very dark time for Stephen King.
Okay.
And what came out of it was the story of It, right? But you fast forward to 2017 and 2019, the producers, the directors, the actors, they're not in that same headspace. So it's going to have a little bit different of a tone. So I feel that it's almost unfair comparing the book to the movie, because they're two totally different takes on the story, right?
Fair enough.
I can agree with that. I definitely would still say compare it to the original miniseries, though.
Really, Josh?
Definitely compare it. It's different media. You can't compare books to the film. You can't, because the books always have more content. But
I also,
the miniseries, I think there's no reason not to compare it to.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Agreed. But I'm going to make one comparison right now between the book and the miniseries, and this is why the movie and the miniseries. I side with the movie more because the people that made it love the source material, have read it back to front, front to back. Like, they love this book. Whereas, who did the original? Tommy Lee Wallace, I think? He's the one that did the first miniseries. He did the miniseries. He never read the book.
Yeah.
He's just going by the script. Oh, that seems cool. Like, it's
But would they have loved the source material so much if the miniseries didn't happen? Because the miniseries is what drove the fame of the book. Big time.
It's true.
In my opinion, for sure.
There's
hundreds of Stephen King books that no one knows.
No, that's absolutely true. It definitely brought that story to more people because, you know, they sat down whenever it premiered and watched part one and they're like, oh my god, this is crazy, right? But more so than people sitting down to actually read the book. But I mean, to be fair, I read the book before I saw the miniseries. And I know Adam did too, didn't you?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So what do you say about that, Josh?
That's not an average.
I know. I'm kidding. Just fucking with you. Again, it's been so long.
It's got all that pent up. I mean, it's absolutely, I agree on all parts, but I agree with Josh 100% that you can definitely do a comparison from the miniseries to the movie to make it more fair, because, you know, the miniseries, a lot of people, and we discussed this before, they look at it with rose colored glasses. It's a part of history. It was during a time when Stephen King books to movies were in a glorious situation. You know, you had shit that was amazing already. Carrie and friggin', you know, Shining and you know, all the way up.
But to be fair, that's happening now.
It is, but once again, people look back at that and they say that was in the heyday when movies were awesome in a certain way and they had a certain look and feel.
Yeah.
The only real thing, I do look back on the original series with some rose-colored glasses. I do have a soft spot for it in my heart, but mainly for Tim Curry.
Yeah.
Because if it was not Tim Curry, I really don't know how the hell that movie would have been pulled off at all.
Like, well, yeah.
He was pinnacle.
Well, the thing that I found about the miniseries was I found all the kid stuff amazing.
Yes.
It was so entertaining, and there's just something, you know, magical and, you know, like about these
Goonies
kids.
Stand By Me.
Yeah. Like these kids trying to overcome a problem. and, you know, in this case is a, you know, shape-shifting demigod from another planet that takes the form of an evil clown. Like, there was just something awesome about it, and I felt that the miniseries really dropped the ball when it came to the adult stuff. Yeah. The adult stuff was very corny, whereas the kid stuff wasn't, right?
Yeah.
And going into Chapter 2, that was the thing that I had the bar set for. How well is this adult cast going to pull off this section of the story and not come across as corny? Just as serious as it was in it Chapter 1. And I would say for the majority of it, I was really happy with what I saw. It felt like the book.
100%.
Yeah.
And a lot of ways, that essence of the novel was there for me.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, let's get into that. Let's talk about the characters and the acting from the actors themselves. First off, absolutely amazingly cast.
Oh yeah. My God, man. Oh my God. Like,
they really put their effort into this to find the proper people to play these characters.
But I mean, the thing that I found really, really, really weird was, like, I'm looking at these characters, not necessarily James McAvoy, Jessica Chastain, or Bill Hader, because I know them from other things. Mm-hmm. But when it came to James Ransom and Jay Ryan as Ben and Eddie, like, especially Ben, like, there was something about his eyes, and I'm like, this looks like that fucking kid.
Yeah.
He talks like the kid, and especially, and same with Eddie, like, they were the adult versions of those kid actors, and, yeah.
Yep. I mean, the guy who played Eddie, I swear, he's got to be some sort of a major method actor where he must have, like, absolutely studied the shit out of the kid. Like, because he had the mannerisms down.
The eyebrows would go up and down, and, like,
And the movement of his mouth, and just, you know, the way that he curled his lips in certain ways, it was like, it was literally Eddie as an adult. It was
I also found, okay, spoilers.
Spoilers, everybody.
Should have announced that at the start of the episode. Spoilers.
Okay. Well, as if a review episode. Okay, yeah. But we'll put it in the notes, but yes, go ahead.
Yes, okay. Stanley, adult Stanley, also looked like child Stanley.
Oh, shit, yeah.
I mean, even though, you know, he wasn't in it very long.
Yeah. Spoiler! Spoiling a book from the 80s and a movie from the 90s and now the new one, yes, but spoiler.
Well, some people don't necessarily watch that.
True.
So from a casting perspective, who liked new Pennywise more than old Pennywise?
Are you talking between Tim Curry versus Skarsgård? Skarsgård, all the way.
Okay.
See, I'm a Curry.
I'm a Skarsgård fan. I think it's a much better fleshed out version of Pennywise. I think that the only thing that was amazing about the original series was Tim Curry, because Tim Curry himself is a fucking amazing actor. Yeah. Everything that he does. Me and the kids and the wife watch the movie Clue all the time.
His role in Home Alone is in Home Alone 2.
He's perfect in everything that he does. Rocky Horror Picture Show, every Halloween, I gotta watch it,
legend.
Right?
Oh my God, legend.
Absolutely. Yeah. And for him to be this maniacal clown that basically just laughs and kills people, absolutely pitch fucking perfect for Tim Curry. But the new one, Bill Skarsgård, he's a Victorian-era looking clown, so he's got a classic look to him, not just a current Ringling Brothers or Barnum and Bailey looking clown with a cheap suit. It's dirtied, it's weathered, it's aged. He looks the part.
Yeah, I definitely love the costuming more.
Yeah.
The costumes.
But to be fair, and I don't want you thinking that I'm shitting on, you know, the Tim Curry version. Tim Curry's version was perfect for 1990.
Yes.
Right? Like, it was perfect for that miniseries. And he rocked the fuck out of that role. Like, he was, when I reread the book, that's who I saw. That's the voice I heard.
Yep.
That was Pennywise. But with the 2017 movie coming out, And then to, you know, now, with the 2019, I found Skarsgård's version more faithful to the version that was in the book. Whereas Tim Curry's was a little bit more cartoony, even though I found Skarsgård kind of cartoony in part two anyway.
Mm.
He wasn't as menacing as he was in the first part.
Yeah, I found him pretty cartoony.
But I found reasoning to that too, which we'll get into. Yeah.
Well, what I was going to say was maybe he's coming off cartoony and kind of childish because the kids are no longer kids anymore and they're adults and they can see through that.
He's excited. He's very much so in the movie. Talks about the fact that he's been craving them. He's been missing them.
Waiting,
he's excited because 27 years later and they're still alive and they're there with him. And he gets to try to exact his revenge. He's overly stupefied excited at this point. That's the impression that I got why he's so much more cartoony in the sequel.
Yeah.
But did you find that he would... Okay. To take some... Get kind of deep here, guys. Ooh. I only found he was cartoony around the Losers Club.
And the kids.
No, when he killed that little girl underneath the bleachers, I didn't find that cartoony. I found that just like he did when he was talking to Georgie. It was kind of off and kind of...
Yeah,
but it was like he's obviously playing a role.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
But what I'm saying is that like there was the same kind of like essence in that, and when he was in the funhouse and he killed the other kid and he was smashed, I thought that was creepy as fuck.
Like, it was, especially when he smiled.
Yeah. Those two scenes in particular, that's Pennywise from chapter one. Like, that was how he was.
Yeah.
But I found, especially when, you know, right after the ritual of Chud, like, he was just, oh, I'm Pennywise, and I'm kind of twitchy, and you know what I mean? And it was awesome. It was a great performance. But I just found that it wasn't scary. It wasn't menacing. And, like, after I was thinking about it today, it was like, well, it's because the kids are now adults, and they don't see him as a menace anymore. He is coming off as...
He's pathetically kind of, goofy.
Yeah.
He's a clown.
Just a clown. Just
he's
a clown.
Just a clown.
Yeah.
Good point.
Yeah.
No, that's getting deep. All right, guys, we're going to take a quick break here, actually. And when we come back, everybody, we're going to talk a little bit more about the characters, and then we're going to jump into some of the effects and the gore, and we'll finish our review. So, coming back in a couple of minutes, everybody.
Hey there, it's Deborah Voorhees from Friday the 13th, Part 5, and you are listening to They Cast from the Coast.
Welcome back, everybody. We're going to continue on with our discussion on It, Chapter 2. So, we were just talking about characters and acting and how this was different, yet the same. And a little bit of that, a little bit of this. So, we talked about the Losers Club and the fact that as adults, perfectly cast in a lot of ways. And then we were talking about Pennywise. Pennywise is, in this one, I mean, it's Pennywise. I think we got a 2-to-1 agreement here that Pennywise in the new series is better in a lot of ways. And
As opposed to... The Curry
version. As opposed to the Curry version. Josh is still a Curry fan. We're all Curry fans.
Don't get me wrong. There's aspects of New Penny that are great. Like I said, the costume's great. There's more of them.
I love Tim Curry.
We see the new Pennywise on screen for way longer than we ever saw Tim Curry on screen.
Yes. Which, going into this, one of the things that we had originally heard from some of the other people reviewing it, or that had seen it even earlier than us, was saying Pennywise wasn't even really on screen very much in episode 2, or chapter 2. I call bullshit on that. I think that they had an assumption that, due to the popularity of the first one, he was going to be, like, everywhere in the second one.
No, and see, the thing is even though it wasn't Skarsgård, necessarily doing the role, Pennywise was in the whole movie.
Everywhere.
Right?
He just wasn't in the clown look the whole time.
And I mean, that's what it was like in the book.
Yeah.
He's a shapeshifter. It just so happens the clown is his favorite form, right?
When he's dealing with children, that's his look, I'm okay to be around and, you know, get in with them type of form, right? If he really wants to make them piss their pants, like in the book, you know, the Wolfman situation or in the leper in the first movie, right? That's when he really, he's sucking up on the fear. Like, that's when he's getting that going. You know, he's playing with them at that point, so.
One of the things that bothered me a little bit, I was a fan of in the book and in It Chapter One of Bill. It seemed very much like he was the main loser in the Losers Club, right?
The leader, yeah.
Yeah, and I felt that his role in this got diminished a little bit, and that's fine, because it's an ensemble
Richie
cast,
seemed
right?
like the leader in this.
Yeah, movie. And it's like, all the focus went on Richie, which is, again, fine, because Bill Hader killed it. Like, he was one of the best things about the film.
Yep.
But you got James McAvoy, who's like, he's a really good actor too, right? And I thought he did really well as Bill, especially when he got back to Derry and he started stuttering. Like, he did the stutter exactly the same as the kid did.
Yeah.
So, I was hoping for a little bit more of his story a little bit, like, you know, just, you know, because he seemed to be the main protagonist of the first film and of the book. But, yeah, I just wanted to say that because it just felt like Richie had more time. And I also felt like Mike didn't have enough. Like, he would show up and go, I'm going to say this exposition and this is what needs to happen. And then that was it.
Yeah.
Yeah, because in the original miniseries, it's told almost from Mike Hamlin's perspective, right? He's kind of the main protagonist and he gets the
narrator,
group all together.
So to speak.
Right.
Well, he's the one that calls everybody back. But again,
and he still does in the new series.
But. Yeah, the miniseries very much followed the same narrative style as the book, like jumping around. Yeah. And I felt one of the pluses to Chapter 1 was it was a straight narrative of them as a kid, right? And it felt like a much stronger story because of that. You got to know the characters more. There wasn't the jumping around. Whereas It Chapter 2 took the narrative of the book and of the miniseries where it was jumping around. And I think that's part and parcel of the fact that, like, the kids were amazing in the first film, so of course we got to show more stuff of them in this one. But I felt that kind of took away from the story a little bit. Like, it was a lot of jumping around.
Okay.
As a non-person that's read the book, something that bothered me in comparison to the miniseries, Beverly Marsh. Is she in the book as kind of like a bad kid? Because in the miniseries, she was always like the innocent girl. And then in this new film, she's smoking, you know, she's kind of rebellious.
In the book, she lashes out in little ways like that, too. I mean, her father's abusive. Her father was the janitor at the school. You know, he was an asshole. You know, it was almost like I don't want to say a female Henry Bowers, but she didn't come from a great bringing up, so she didn't have certain things to kind of, you know, leash her in as to, you know, proper etiquette and doing certain things. But it was the Losers Club that kind of she settled.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And she became, and it turned out that it was more of just her lashing out, you know what I mean? And she wasn't really a bad kid. It was just a perception.
Well, Beverly,
that's how I interpret
it. No, and that's but the way that the character in the modern movie, like 2017-2019, I feel is a mashup between both. Like, the book, she was kind of a badass because, like you said, Adam, she came from, you know, kind of a fucked up home.
Yeah.
And that was like I feel that like the book is the middle and the original miniseries, she's very innocent. And then I feel that the new one is like a blend of the two, right? Because she is very innocent, but, you know, she does smoke and she does, you know, hang out with a group of boys.
And steal. Against,
you yeah. know, and steal and stuff like that. Yeah.
But I still think it's an innocent way. It's not like she's going around torturing animals and she's not you know, like beating the shit out of
people. Yeah, she's no Bauer.
She's the one who gets bullied, but then, you know, retaliates by stealing a pack of smokes and smoking them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
she's bad. She's bad, but she's not bad.
No, she's not bad at all. She's just, you know,
rebellious
she's trying,
teenager.
She's just badass.
Yeah, she's trying to. Well, I mean, she's trying to find her confidence in, you know, her self worth. Where she's got a fucking creepy dad that treats her like shit, and you know, she's bullied at school, and it's like, you know, I've seen people like that. I was kind of like that. I wasn't bullied. You know what I mean? Like, you know, it's that kind of weird time where she was like what 13, 14 years old in the original, and you know, so
Yeah, I mean, she was definitely a little bit more innocent in the original. That's for damn sure.
Yeah, mousy, right?
Yeah, exactly.
But again, that goes to the time setting too, because I mean, it was set in the '50s, and girls weren't necessarily.
This is true. You know, yeah, I suppose. Right? Yeah,
that's true.
Never considered that, right? You know, the spunky little redhead chick that smokes and steals, and you know.
Yeah. Exactly. Okay.
Beats the shit out of her father.
Which was definitely awesome. So, we got to go back to Bill Hader for a second, though.
Do we?
Because you said it flat out. He fucking stole the show. Yeah, and I said it earlier.
Yeah,
he did.
One of the biggest complaints that I heard from people after seeing the movie, and even before seeing the movie, is a lot of people are like, it's too much comedy. There was too much Bill Hader jokes.
No.
He is a joking character.
Every joke landed for me. There was no point where it was just unnecessary. Every joke landed.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. But I didn't. Bill Hader became Richie.
Yeah.
Right. Like he was the character, and Finn Wolfhard was like the exact same in his, and like yeah, it comes across as Bill Hader being funny, but no, that's just Richie.
Yeah.
It was Richie being Richie. Like, it was the smart ass. It wasn't Bill Hader jokes. It was Richie jokes, right? And, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't... He didn't ruin it. He didn't... He was...
Yeah, he was great.
When they're in the dark, and he's pretending to be Pennywise, that I think that was...
Oh, like, my God, and he's like, you guys all suck.
Remember when he used to do that little dance?
Yeah. Did the voice so good.
He did the voice. Yeah. But in all honesty, with everything that Bill Hader's character, you know, Richie did for joking, Eddie stole the show with his final joke for me. Right? Yeah. Spoiler alert, everybody! You know, if you've read the book and you've seen the miniseries or whatever, right? When Eddie's dying, he literally, you know, basically makes a joke about fucking Richie's mom. Like... You know, like, it was hilarious just because it was such an inappropriate time. And you could see Richie kind of like, he was proud. There was a pride moment there for some reason. Like, I know you're dying, but wow. That was great.
Yeah.
It was good. So.
I feel like, Adam, if we were in the same situation and I was Richie, I'd say the same thing.
Probably it would be the same thing for me too.
Like, not necessarily about your mom, but like something inappropriate.
It'd be something totally inappropriate, right?
Yeah.
What did you guys think of the King cameo, the junk shop owner?
I thought it was great. I thought it was so good, and I love the meta joke about the bad endings.
Yeah, I thought
that was so good, and I was actually
You with me too?
Driving, and he yelled.
All right, stop for a second.
What?
You literally cut out, so I'm just going to cut it and edit it. When you said, start again talking about Stephen King, you said it was, you said about the endings, the meta joke, and then you cut. Go ahead.
I just, yeah, it was a really good use of a cameo. Apparently there's rumors that he's going to start doing that in all his movies and be the horror Stan Lee.
I hope so.
I think that'd be great. But one of the things that I was really shocked and, you know, surprised with was the whole adding Bill's bike, Silver, where they didn't really emphasize that much in the original, like in chapter one, but like when he was riding it and like, you know, he had a bond with this bike and he's talking to it and then, hey, oh, Silver, away. Like, I couldn't believe that, because that was in the book, right?
Yeah.
And I think that was also in the miniseries. So I was really happy. And there was a couple points in the movie where they added things that should have been in part one, but I'm glad that they were in it anyway.
Yeah. Like, right? About Silver, I agree. I like when Stephen King was like, I don't know how fast she'll go. She'll outrun the devil.
Yeah.
Right? It's perfect, because in the book and in the original miniseries, she'll outrun the devil, and one day she did. You know what I mean? Yeah. And there was that whole situation where they literally took off on it. Him and Stanley, I think it was Stanley on the back of the bike.
Yeah.
Because they were in the house and... Yeah,
they were in the house and... Yeah. Exactly.
I love how you repeated exactly what I just said.
Exactly what you just said, yeah.
And when he gets on the bike and the handlebars are going down and the tire's flat and it's falling apart.
It's such a perfect, imperfect situation. He was in love with his bike, but it was falling apart on him, and it was great. Yeah. It was great. So, let's have just a general discussion about the movie itself now. So anything that kind of comes to mind, or anything... you know, else that we can fill in to talk about here. One of the big things that really stood out for me was that, as we had said, the miniseries was more of a narrative story, you know, by Mike talking about what's going on, much like the book and everything else. And with that, it seemed that there had to be certain things that were truly explained. And what I mean by all of that is the fact that, like, in the miniseries, when Bill starts stuttering, it's very openly, Bill, you're stuttering. I haven't stuttered since I was a kid, right? But in this, it happens. And it's like, you can see that they recognize what's going on, right? And you, as the viewer, recognize that for the first half an hour of the movie, he's been perfectly fine. And then all of a sudden he starts to stutter because things are coming back to him. And that's the discussion, is that things are coming back.
Yeah.
It's like he forgot that he stuttered.
Yeah, it's almost like that was part of his childhood, so it was gone. Just like the rest of it. And another one that stood out for me like that was when Beverly Marsh went to the apartment to see if her father was there. And it was on the door, it said Marsh. And then when she looks back, it said Kirsch. And it was same in the miniseries, same in the book and everything else. But in the miniseries, when she realizes that shit's about to go down and things got really dark all of a sudden, she goes, it did say Marsh on the door, didn't it? You know what I mean? Like, it had to point that out to you. Yeah. Whereas in this, you knew that it said Marsh on the door, and then it said Kirsch. And then all of a sudden shit starts to happen, and then the whole place changes. And you realize... Yeah. Yes, it did say Marsh on the door. You know what I mean? Like, it's an instantaneous. They didn't have to spoon feed you with this movie some of those details. They were placed in such a way where it was in your face and you picked up on it and the realization was there automatically. They didn't have to monologue it. Let's put it that
way. Well, I think it falls into the same type of thing that they did with chapter one, where they really wanted to put you in the position of the protagonist. So, like, how Pennywise in the library behind Ben in the first movie, where she's, like, staring at him in the background, like, you know, what am I seeing right now? Or the whole theory about how Pennywise's eyes, one's pointing at the character and one's pointing at you, right? Like it put you in the movie, and I felt very much that same vibe with that. Like you said, it did say Marsh on the door. Yep. Do you know what I mean? Like, but we're going through it with the character, right? And then all of a sudden, oh, this building's fucked.
And there's a big old naked witch woman coming after me.
Yeah. Oh, I'm not going to lie, even though I knew it was coming, it's still kind of...
Yeah.
What the fuck?
Well, I wasn't expecting, you know, like a 10-foot-tall one.
Yeah, the plot device of the tokens. I think it was a good way to get them separated. I don't remember how organic it felt in the original miniseries, that they were all kind of on their own thing, but this, I think they did a good job.
Well, in the original miniseries, they never really touched on anything like that. They just, when they were split up, it was for just various simple things. And it wasn't like any kind of like a, you have to do this, come back like that thing, right? But...
Was it like that in the book?
If I remember correctly, in the book, it wasn't that they had to go off and do things. It was when they came to town, it was a little bit more like the miniseries, that when they came to town, they all experienced shit before they came together.
Yeah.
And from those experiences, if I remember correctly, that's how they realized that they had tokens to produce for this ritual. So it's not like they all went off and did their own thing after the fact. It was all like, oh my gosh, like, I can contribute to the ritual because of this or because of that.
Yeah.
But it wasn't so in your face. But I did like it because it was, like you said, it was a good plot point to separate them, which is interesting because, once again, the whole idea of the fact that they're stronger together, now they're weaker in separate states. You know, even if there's two of them, they're still weaker than the whole group.
I also liked it because I think it was very well orchestrated. It felt very organic how each one of them had a child part and then the adult part. And they kind of overlapped each other. And, like, you were getting, like, a good Pennywise scene. Do you know what I mean? Like, him fucking with them, right?
And you knew them that way that kids, you were guaranteed a good scene with each one of them.
Yeah, and I like that because it not only gave, you know, the individual character a moment to shine and have a little character development and all that kind of stuff, and learn a little bit more of their past that wasn't added in, you know, chapter one, but again, you got a Pennywise scene, whether it was the clown, whether it was, you know,
Miss Kirsch.
The big naked lady.
Paul Bunyan.
Yeah, the Paul Bunyan scene. Yeah.
Which actually I really liked when the Paul Bunyan, it was like, you know, the big wooden statue and it like screams at him. It's all like all the jagged, you know,
pieces of wood type of thing.
Shit that was, you know, it was interesting. It was good. I liked it. But actually the best part of that entire thing with Richie and Pennywise in the town square was when Pennywise is talking to him and you see everybody in the background turn their attention.
And they start dancing and going back and forth, and
it was like they were all in on it. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like it was that kind of a surrounding situation. It was good.
Yeah.
Tim, do you have any trivia?
I have a bunch of trivia.
What kind of trivia? Because are
we ending the episode so soon?
We're not ending the episode by any means, but I think it's definitely time for some Trivia Time with Tim! Trivia Time with Tim!
Okay, well, right off the bat, this is one thing that I just learned. I had no idea this actually happened, but when filming for The Shining was going on, Stephen King was on set, and they shared the same lot with a little indie film called Empire Strikes Back. I don't know if you guys heard of it. But it was being filmed at the same time, which is directed by Irvin Kershner. Mrs. Kirsch is named after Irvin Kershner, which I thought was... Nice. Like, I just found that out, and I thought that was really cool.
That is good.
Okay, so a lot of these trivia seem to be about Bill Hader. So just like the film focusing on him, I guess Trivia Time with Tim will focus on him a little bit. Apparently, Bill Hader was approached for the role of Richie based on Finn Wolfhard's wish to cast him in the sequel. Hader, who had never met with Wolfhard, was extremely flattered that he wanted him for the role. And it's just kind of fucked how like this kid like threw it out there. And then it happened. right?
That's pretty cool.
And the same thing happened with Sophia Lillis that she threw out Jessica Chastain. But some conspiracy theorists think that they were already cast in the roles and they just got the kids to say that. Right? Because if you notice, like, none of the other kids got who would they wanted. All right. Bill Skarsgård stated in an interview that even after filming had wrapped, he would have nightmares about Pennywise. In these nightmares, he would have to battle Pennywise just as the characters in the film do. How fucked is that? That the actor of Pennywise was having nightmares of, like, fighting Pennywise.
Basically fighting himself.
It's kind of fucked. What's another one?
Well, there should be at least one trivia that we need to put out there. We found out that the character, or the actor who played Ben Hanscom in the original miniseries appears in this movie. Well, the one who played Ben as a kid.
Yeah.
Appears in Chapter 2. He is actually, when they're introducing Ben Hanscom as an adult, he's the, well, I don't know what you want to put, the White Rabbit? The character that's very prominent on the screen at that time, that's kind of talking about architectural design. And you're like, that looks like it would be Ben Hanscom, and all of a sudden it's not. And it turns out that it was the original Ben Hanscom.
There's a lot of weird things with this movie and the number 27. Well, especially with the first one.
Like,
the 1990 miniseries came out.
Yeah.
And then 27 years later, it Chapter 1, right?
Right.
Which we believe that they did plan it that way because it was kind of in development for
Yes. Bill Skarsgård was 27 when he filmed it Chapter 1.
That's interesting.
But for Chapter 2, continuing the extreme coincidence of the number 27, in this film, actually, this film is set to be released on September 6th, 2019. 9 plus 6 plus 2 plus 0 plus 1 plus 9 is 27. The first chapter of It 2017 was released on September 8th, 2017. 9 plus 8 plus 2 plus 0 plus 1 plus 7 is 27.
Can't be coincidental. You know that's all
I'm getting. There's a 27 years age gap between Isaiah Mustafa,
who played Mike Hanlon as an adult,
yeah, and Chosen Jacobs, young Mike, as well as Teach Grant, who played Henry Bowers, and old Henry Bowers, and Nicholas Hamilton, who played young Henry. So there's 27 years between that. And that's all I have for the 27 years.
Some good 27 numbers.
Yeah. And apparently this movie took 86 days to shoot.
Nice.
And Stephen King doesn't call this a sequel, but the second half to a big story.
Good way to put it.
And with that, I bring an end to Trivia Time with Tim.
Trivia Time with Tim! Excellent.
Here's a good one.
You gotta get in on this theme song, man.
Trivia Time with Tim!
No.
Okay, it's done. Go ahead, Josh, you have something.
Yeah, so one of my favorite scenes from the original miniseries, the Chinese restaurant scene, which they did an excellent job redoing in this one, that restaurant that they filmed in the original miniseries was the same restaurant that Jerry Seinfeld, Elaine, and Costanza were waiting at in the restaurant, the Chinese restaurant episode.
Yeah.
I like that.
That scene was, especially when the waitress comes in.
Yeah, just everything all right?
Is everything okay?
Yeah.
It's not like, you know, what the hell are you doing? Is everything okay?
Yeah, but she's not going to get mad at them anyway. Because they're all millionaires.
True.
Remember? They're all millionaires.
That's because they have The Shining.
Did you see how much fucking food they bought?
Yeah. Well, they're all super successful.
Right.
Except for poor old Mike.
Yeah, yeah, he didn't leave.
He didn't leave. That's right.
Well, you know what? Knowledge is success on its own.
Wow.
And he
more,
was very
the more you know. All right. So I'm going to open up the floor to anything
please,
else.
Please, the actual edit of this episode, please, can you put that, the more you know?
It might have already been shown on power. The screen by now, Tim. All right. I'm going to open up the floor. Any open other topics that you want to talk about when it comes to this movie?
Adam, I know you really liked the final form of Pennywise with the face still there and it wasn't like full crab.
Yeah, so that was the thing. So when we went into the movie last night, I literally looked at everybody and I said, I don't think it's going to be the full crab form. I don't think it's going to be anything too...
It's going to be a spider, he says.
It's going to be like an arachnid type of creature, but it's still going to be Pennywise. Well, holy sheep shit. Because after the movie, Tim was like, yeah, as soon as it turned into the creature, I looked and I said, fuck.
He was right.
He was right. And I liked the form. I thought it was great because it really did play on more of the Pennywise that we've come to know. So instead of being this intergalactic eater of worlds spider creature, he still was as they would vision him, Pennywise, the clown. But an arachnid with multiple legs and about 30 feet high, you know, with Pennywise's head. And the funny thing was, is that his body was draped in the clothing. So, like, all of his legs actually had, you know, clothing.
Little tufts.
Little tufts.
Well, apparently in the miniseries, that's what they wanted to do as well. They wanted to have Tim Curry's head on the spider, but the effects were not there, so they just decided to make it just the spider crab.
Now, before we go any further, guys, we really got to talk about effects work, the scares and the gore and everything that got put into this movie, because, you know, Josh put up a good point. I really enjoyed the final form of Pennywise. You know, it stood out to me. It was an incredible looking creature, in my opinion. Yeah, some people are going to say it kind of looks a little bit cheesy with the CGI and stuff, but he's a clown character. You know what I mean? And
who can look like anything?
Who can look like anything? And he's some sort of a, you know, dimensional intergalactic eater of worlds. Use your imagination, folks. Like he's literally combined himself into two different looks and feel all in the same. I thought it was good. I really didn't mind it at all. At first, when it happened, the head, the size of the head on the body and stuff like this, I was kind of like, okay. But as the scene went on, I became more comfortable with it and made more sense to have it done that way. And I appreciated it. By the end of it, I really appreciated it because I don't think that they would have been able to create the end character or the end form of Pennywise to be anything of an emoting, joking, you know, shit-disturbing character that he is if it was a crab creature. You know what I mean? It had to be Pennywise, but the appendages were there. You know what I mean? For him, because he was tossing off quips and quirks and are you scared? And coming after them. And it was great. It was great.
Oh, when he was going around, like...
Oh, like, that was perfect.
I love that. I felt the effects work overall was pretty good. I wish they would have relied a little bit more on practical for some of the stuff. Because some of the stuff, you're spending all... Like, it's the highest grossing horror movie of all time.
Yeah.
So, throw some money at the effects a little bit. Like, example, Mrs. Kirsch. Okay. In her big form.
Her it big was really nakedness. Creepy.
It was really creepy, but that's a CG character.
Yeah.
Right?
Played by Javier Botet, and he's creepy as shit to begin with when he does his characters, so...
Yeah, I don't know, I just felt like, some of the awesomeness of the movie was lost with some of the CG effects. Now, I felt Pennywise with his mouth opening was a lot better in this one, because the little girl under the bleachers, like, he was out of focus and then just snapped at her.
Yeah.
Like, that was awesome. And I almost wish that the Georgie scene from Chapter 1 was a little bit more like that. Because, like, you got this amazing acting back and forth between Georgie and Pennywise. And then, all of a sudden, like, this... And, like, he bites down and his eyes cross. And I'm just like...
Yeah, so I remember that was your biggest gripe about the CGI in the first one, was just that one scene.
Yeah, but... I don't know, I felt that they accomplished it a little bit better in this one, but there were still some things that I wish could have been better.
See, I'm a pure blood practical effects, but I honestly feel like this film didn't need them. It's telling more of like a grand story, and I don't think the practical effects really could have done it justice for what's out there, for some of the things they wanted to do.
No, there's definitely things that you could not do with practical.
Yeah.
But I feel with...
But maybe the bite itself, like when it shows a close-up or something like this of the bite happening.
Yeah.
You know, a practical creature or biting.
Maybe just better CG. I mean, I've seen amazing CG before, right? But, yeah. I mean, with that being said, they de-aged those kids. And I think for the most part, it was pretty good.
Yeah, I don't...
Exactly.
I didn't really notice the problem, but there are other people online today going, the de-aging looked like shit. I'm like, did we watch the same fucking movie? Because I thought it looked great.
There was one scene where it was weird. And I noticed that their voices were turned higher.
Okay.
And they were higher than what they would have been in the first movie. Like, they were compensating. But it was... when they first go down into the smokehouse, the underground clubhouse they made, specifically Richie and Eddie.
Oh, Eddie. Okay.
And Ben too, but specifically Richie and Eddie. Like, Eddie's voice was like turned up a little high.
You don't know what was going on in his personal life at that point.
Maybe. But aside from that, like, the effects were good.
The only scene that I had a problem with the effects that kind of, to me, seemed like it could have been done just a little bit better was the first kill in the movie with the guy who was thrown over the bridge, and Pennywise picks him up, and he bit right into his chest.
Yeah.
That was the one that kind of seemed a little out of place to me. Like, Pennywise killing him is fine, but the biting and the way that the angle that it happened and the look of it, it did remind me a little bit more of the Georgie one from the first, where it just kinda,
when he stands back up and like,
oh, and he's going up like this, and he's like, shit's hanging.
Yeah, it was
perfect.
It was dope. And that was a scene that I was very happy that they put it in, because that's literally the opening scene of the book. But I found that whole scene made me uncomfortable when they were beating the shit out of the two of them. Like, not necessarily the fact that it was two gay guys getting beat up by these hateful assholes, but just there was one punch. I felt it.
Oh, yeah.
I felt it, right? Done. Like, yeah. And, like, I just... And, you know, no one's going to save them.
No.
Obviously, because Pennywise... But the underwater... And he's looking at the shoreline, and he kind of sees Pennywise, and, like, the eyes are glowing.
And the hand.
Yeah, it was so good. It was so good.
That was good. That was
good. One of my favorite effect scenes were the leper. It reminded me so much of, like, a Sam Raimi film.
Yeah.
The bile coming out and the tongue wiggling around. Like,
I even found, like, the color palette of that basement.
Yeah.
Reminded me of Raimi.
Yeah, Raimi-esque, yeah. Especially, I mean, he's in a basement. There's shit all over the place.
Yeah.
And there's a draped curtain, and it's kind of like the Evil Dead moment. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
where you're
gonna
pull it off, right? And it was good. I think some of the best effects in the movie, in my opinion, had to do with when they were in the underground dealing with Pennywise, and it was the scenes with Ben and Beverly, and they were being thrown around.
Yeah.
Like, it really stood out to me for some reason. It was simple, stupid shit, but it was like when they got thrown through, like, those doors.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then they ended up where they were, and it was such a fast-paced moment for everybody that it's almost like you didn't have time to linger and look for anything.
No.
It was in your face.
That brings up another thing that's been said online that last night Josh called bullshit, and I have since agree. Apparently, this is the most blood used in a fucking horror movie.
I called bullshit on that last night.
I don't remember. I just remember Josh being very vocal, saying, I call bullshit. Now, there was a lot of blood in that scene, but there was a lot of blood in chapter one, where the bathroom, like, that's enough blood to cover a room.
The only way I can see that was the most blood ever used in a movie is, did it take them 3 days of using that amount of blood continuously swirling in there to film it?
Maybe. You know what I mean?
Because in reality, Evil Dead 2013
has
the most blood ever filmed. I don't care what anybody says. It's raining blood, it was for raining. Damn sake.
Well, I mean, yeah. Well, I mean, even any Evil Dead.
Yeah,
any Evil Dead.
It's pouring out the walls.
Yeah. So, exactly. That could be very, very well what it could have meant. That
it was the most practical blood use, maybe, on set.
Yeah, and they had to keep doing that scene. Yeah.
And they had to waste some and reuse some because maybe it got tainted and discolored and coagulated, and they had to bring in more or some shit like that. It could have just been the effort involved to film it.
Yeah,
they had to use more blood. But it was definitely not the most blood on screen.
Seen on screen. No,
it was not even close. Not even close.
No.
Yeah, not even close.
All right, well, okay. I'm glad we sorted that out.
Absolutely. So the effects work was good. The scares. So just in general, one of the big things that everybody's talking about this too, and Jacob, we took my son to go see it last night. He was there with us. And he was sitting right beside me, and he was kind of like butted up against me. And every time something jumped, my shoulder just went flying because he was like, ah, every time. He's easy to jump scare. Every time. He's easy for jump scares, and it's great because you can see the enjoyment of a horror movie with him, and he loves that. So I could easily be wrong, but I counted probably about a good 6 that got him easily last night. But this movie, more so than the first one, was pretty heavy on jump scares.
Yeah, and I the one that got me was Henry, adult Henry, moving the thing from underneath the bed, and what's his name, the zombified version of
Stouter.
Yeah, which was fucking dope.
Yeah.
He looked fucking amazing, but like but that was it. Like, I didn't really jump, and I almost feel that the jump scares kind of took away from the movie because it's like, oh fuck, now it's just a modern horror movie now.
Well, you gotta think, it is the highest grossing horror movie of all time, and it's appealing to general audience. So, you know, what's the most common thing the general audience wants out of a horror movie? The jump scare, the build up, the tension, right?
But I am happy to say they did not rely on that, because...
No.
100%. It was a side thought.
Yeah.
But...
And I like the jump scare. The generic jump scare, because, like you said, you can watch someone else get scared. That's the enjoyment.
Yeah.
Like, the classic horror fans aren't going to be scared because they know it's coming.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like, you can feel it, and you're just kind of like, it's going to happen. Oh, there it is. Okay, right? So, with that being said, favorite scenes in the movie? Josh.
I think the leper scene. Yeah, the leper scene.
In the basement.
And as far as, like, the classic Pennywise to see the clown, I really like the under the bleachers, the 1-2. Pause. Yeah, that was good.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, okay. Tim?
any scene that had Pennywise, really. But the bleacher scene was really good. I was kind of disturbed with the funhouse scene where he kept smashing his head, and the licking of the tongue up the thing.
Yeah, like, you can hear it first.
Yeah. I thought those two scenes, those two scenes for me were price of admission, even though it was free for me, but price of admission. Those were what I wanted out of that movie. Like, that type of Pennywise, him doing what Pennywise does, is, like, eating kids.
Yeah.
Scaring them, feeding off their fear, and then eating them. And that's what I wanted more of, but I'm very thankful for those two scenes. But, like I said, any scene that had him in it, whether it was Skarsgård or someone else, you know, in as Pennywise, those were probably my favorite scenes. But I mean, again, I enjoyed the adults. I enjoyed their. It felt very much like the next part of the story. Like, I was really happy. I was happy. But those two, the bleacher scene, Josh stole it from me, which is fine because it was perfect. The counting down, and she's just there with her cheek out, and he's like cross-eyed, just like the Georgie scene, and he's dripping, drooling, just staring at her, and then she goes, three, ah! That was really good.
Yeah.
I'm still smiling. And you know what's awesome, guys? I get to see it again tomorrow. Again.
Bastard. I know.
Favorite scene? Yeah, Josh and Tim, you both got it for me. The bleachers was actually my favorite scene. It's because it was classic Pennywise, and it was totally unexpected for me to see a scene like that in this movie. Right? Yeah, and
it's in the trailer.
No.
I didn't watch trailers.
No, it's not that. It's what went into the scene. It wasn't just, oh, she's under the bleachers, and all of a sudden Pennywise gets her. The discussion that he had with her.
Hello, I love how he does that.
And the whole, you know, I'm scared of letting people see my face, and he's crying, and he's hiding his face like a little child, and like,
well, he said that because that's what she's going through,
exactly,
right?
Exactly. Yeah. But that whole banter between them, and his perfect acting to the situation as to how a clown would act, you know what I mean, in that kind of a joking situation. It was absolutely, utterly perfect for me. But if I had to choose another one, I'd say it was probably the reveal of Pennywise as the spider creature at the end. And Tim, you brought this up a little bit earlier. When they come in and they do their thing and, you know, they're kind of on the outside of, like, the big meteorite, you know, landing area. And there's, like, all that glass-like sand that's, you know, frozen into place, and he's sitting there creeping around the corner, mm-hmm. looking at them, and he's kind of, you know, touching and looking, and he's talking to them, and just all of a sudden he steps out, and it's like, wow, boom. Yeah, boom, 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 boom. Yeah. But just when he was creeping around, it was the first time in the movie that I found that he was actually being creepy towards them. Like, he was actually pulling what he would have done to them as kids, you know, like talking to them and, you know, oh, you think that's the way that it is and blah, blah, blah. And then all of a sudden he reveals himself like, you can't fuck with me at this point, guys. Like, almost like he was getting, you know.
Well, this goes back to something I mentioned earlier, how they put in things that I was hoping for in chapter one that I liked from the miniseries and the book. Was certain little pieces of dialogue, like when he is like, you can't fuck with me, I'm the eater of worlds. Like, the fact that he said that, I was giddy. And then when Ben was getting his token and he was in the fucking locker and he's like, kiss me, fat boy, I was like, yes, because I wanted that. Because that's one of my favorite, because I think I said that to you once or twice, Adam.
Yeah, you did. Yeah, you did. It's embarrassing, but okay. And not only that, at one point, Beverly beep, beep, Richie.
Beep, yeah.
Right?
Yeah. She does it properly. Richie. You understand the context. Yeah.
Exactly.
Did it properly. But it was all those little things, including of the gay couple at the start, All the, when they were collecting the tokens, how they were adding things from the book that I remembered that I thought should have been in chapter one. Like, I'm very excited to watch chapter one, chapter two back to back.
Yeah. Which is pretty much what we did. We watched chapter one the night before, and then we watched chapter two, obviously, last night.
I'm talking like one sitting, 5 hours.
I'm totally down for that. I'm pulling down the projector, and I'm doing that when it comes out, that's for sure. All right, gentlemen. I think what we need to do at this point is we need to actually give the movie a rating.
What do we rate it?
So, okay, for anybody who's, you know, listened to our show before, we've had different types of rating systems in the past.
We got a de facto fucking amazing rating system. New. First time ever seen. On YouTube.
Yay! Okay. we're taking a page out of the book of our friends at the MPAA, and we're going to give these a proper rating.
Our friends.
They're our friends, Tim. They're our
sponsored friends.
They know what's best for us, Tim. Yeah. And we're going to actually give them ratings as if we rated movies for the viewers, the audience. We're not going to rate it as if it's, you know, how many stars out of five or whatever have you. It's who are we rating this for is really what it comes down to. And we're going to start off on the very bottom. Let's give a quick little recap of this, a little overview. It's going to be, is the movie rated S for shit? Is the movie going to be G, rated G for good?
For good.
Is the movie going to be rated PG for pretty good? Or is the movie going to be rated R for recommended? I think it's pretty good that way, guys.
So, I'm very happy that we came up with this at the last minute for this episode.
We really did, by the way.
Thousands of hours went into this.
It's really good. Like, it's really good. I'm really... Yeah, it just feels right. It just feels right.
So is it S for shit, good, pretty good, or recommended? Josh!
So, I was at good, and then... They showed the turtle, so we were pretty good.
They showed a turtle, okay?
And then, on the very end, on the marquee, they had Nightmare on Elm Street 5 playing, so I gotta give it an R, recommended.
Wow.
You know, the same in the first one, too.
That poster was in his bedroom.
The Lost Boys poster, too, yeah, is that what you mean? Nightmare.
There was a Nightmare poster in Chapter 1.
Yeah, it was also on the marquee at the Capitol or whatever it was.
Yeah. And then they had the Lost Boys poster down in the clubhouse. That was cool too. So yeah,
and they did have a throwback to the New Kids on the Block poster in the locker.
Yeah.
Yeah, they had me with the New Kids poster.
Donnie
and the music. Yeah, Donnie. But that was Danny in the showed. Get your New Kids facts right, bud.
All right, fine. So we got a rated R for recommended from Josh. Tim?
I went into this with a rated R, and I dropped down to a PG, but then upon thinking about it and going on a sabbatical, finding myself and what I truly feel about this movie, I'm gonna recommend it because it's the perfect ending to chapter one, and it's supposed to be one story, so you can't really compare one to the other. It's not a sequel. It's like Stephen King said, it's the continuation of the story.
Part two.
Yeah. Chapter two. Okay. So I went into the movie thinking it was definitely rated R. I recommend it all the way. Couple of little scenes here and there, I kind of dropped down to a pretty good and a good. Just, you know, like I said, the actual bite at the beginning. But when he kind of came back up and his shit was hanging out of his mouth and stuff like this, it redeemed, so it was good. I didn't feel that the movie dragged on like some people are saying that it does. I thought that the movie had a great pacing.
Oh, God, buddy, when you got to pee, you drank one of those right here. You drank one of those. It dragged.
Well, man, all I can say is you could have pissed back into one of those if you really wanted to. We wouldn't have judged you, but, you know. But I ended up, and at the very end, I ended up this movie for me is rated R for recommended.
So we got three R's.
Three R's. Recommended, recommended, recommended. Good job, everybody. So, Big Cast from the Coast highly recommends this movie for all of the purposes that we've been talking about tonight. The movie is a fantastic continuation of the first chapter, and it's a bittersweet yet perfect ending to basically an epic tale. It really is.
Yeah.
And I mean, it couldn't ask for better.
It's not a perfect movie.
But I mean, really, what movie is absolutely, utterly perfect? And I know you're going to say something. There's a couple of things out there.
Okay. For the sake of the episode and the sake of the point that you're trying to make, I will not say anything.
Okay. But for
did you see me go?
I know. But for every movie that you think is perfect, somebody else has a problem with it. You can't.
Yeah, wrong people.
That's the one I was going to say.
You can't please everybody. So technically, in my opinion, there's no such thing as an absolute perfect movie.
Josh, you know what I was going to say?
What movie were you going to say, Tim? Just say it.
Empire Strikes Fucking Back is a perfect.
It's as close to a fucking perfect movie as you can get.
No, it is perfect film.
I guarantee there are people who hate it. But oh well.
Isn't that little indie movie that they were filming on the same set?
Yeah.
I think I heard of that.
Check it out if you haven't seen it, Josh.
It's that old movie that Spider-Man was talking about.
Yeah.
That's right. Oh well. So, with that being said, everybody, it's time to say goodbye. We're going to close off this episode. So, thank you everybody for tuning in tonight. And don't forget, check us out on Facebook. Check us out on YouTube. That's where all of our videos are stored. We're also available as a podcast on iTunes and various other podcasting platforms. So check us out. Like, subscribe, enjoy, share it, share the love.
Leave comments. If you guys got thoughts of what you want us to talk about, things that you liked about this episode, anything.
Absolutely.
Making fun of Adam, anything.
Goes without saying. Everybody makes fun of Adam, so, you know. All right.
They really do. I'm so sorry, friend. I'm so sorry.
Don't be. Nobody else is.
I really am. I really am.
No, he's not.
I totally am.
No, he's not.
Until next time, Josh.
I like turtles.
Tim?
Stay spooky, everybody.
There it is. Have a good night, everybody. See you next time.
Bye!